Hello and welcome to Capital Conversations. This is NET News' weekly series of discussions with policymakers whose decisions affect Nebraskans' lives. With me today is Senator Mike Groene of North Platte. Thanks very much for coming in.
Thanks, Fred, for inviting me.
Can you tell folks a little bit about what you do outside of the hallowed walls of the Capitol?
Oh, I love being an American. I'm in agriculture. I was born and raised on a farm, so you know, you follow what you know. And when I went off to the university, I took ag economics and marketing and just followed that career down the trail. And I managed ag retail outlets. But for the last 20 years or so, I've been in marketing, selling specialized fertilizer equipment in a three-state area. Hmm. It's been a good living.
Okay. Do you find that selling fertilizer equipment has any bearing on what you do here?
Yeah, a little bit. It's got to make the pitch, you know.
Okay.
And you got to close the deal.
One of the first things that you did, and this is your first year in the legislature, is you led a successful filibuster against a bill that would have required school children to be vaccinated against meningitis. Can you tell us a little bit about that experience and why you took that stand?
Bacterial meningitis. I didn't plan on filibustering. I did, but I really believed in the issue, and I learned, because I've been involved in some politics, that you come with facts, you don't come with emotion. So I did the research at the CDC and came up with what I thought was rational thinking and a process, and I presented it to the people, and I had 18 other senators agree that educational process in our schools and to parents about the vaccination and the dangers of meningitis was a better route than mandating it. And the reason, it's a very rare disease, and I couldn't see where this was coming from, this legislation, because we hadn't had a case in the state of Nebraska the previous year from all ages. And then I did a little further research with the Health and Human Service Department of Nebraska and found out that in that age group they were going to vaccinate from seventh grade through college age, we'd only had 9 cases in the last 12 years, 11 years or so. And there was no guarantee that the vaccination, it wasn't a highly effective vaccination. It only covered 3/4 of the bacteria out there. And then it caught in my craw that, wait a second, if a parent is out there and vaccinated their child and the government said, you're safe, and a child woke up with extreme headaches and vomiting, that mom and dad would sit there and say, what is it, meningitis, because we vaccinated them. But he had a 25% chance that they could. And then more research found out that the CDC took it from a 10-year to a 5-year effective vaccination, and after 3 years, the effective rate was only 58%. I follow facts, and so that really concerned me. And at that point, I decided it'd be better to educate parents of those information I just relayed to you, so they knew if they decided to vaccinate their child, to still be on the alert.
So it wasn't a matter of principle that the government should not impose requirements on people. Would you extend the logic that you used against the meningitis vaccine to other vaccinations that are currently on the books? You know, measles,
My children were vaccinated. I wasn't, because I'm old enough. I had mumps. I had measles. I'm past that age group that was vaccinated. But my children were. My granddaughter is attending Wesleyan University, and she got vaccinated in order to go there.
And do you think that ought to be a government requirement, or do you think
I like the op-outs for religious reasons and for medical reasons. That should always be there. But I understand when we herd together in cities, you give up some freedoms because diseases are more prevalent and can change. But every disease, not all diseases are equal, you know, understand.
So that was one of the first things you did. Now, one of the most recent things you did, last week, it was kind of a shot across the bow on the budget. There's a proposal that to let people in nursing homes keep an additional $10 a month for personal spending, which would trigger additional Medicaid spending. And you tried to scale back the additional Medicaid spending. What was your thinking on that?
Well, and you said it there at the last, it's only for Medicaid. People, well, not just elderly. If you're handicapped or disabled, a younger person, and you're in an assisted living situation and you're on Medicaid, all your money, your Social Security money, your Social Security disability money, goes to the facility, which it should, to pay bills. But we were allowing them to keep $50 a month for haircuts or can of pop or something or whatever they didn't get. Well, then it hadn't been changed since 99, and I agreed, let's raise it a little to $60. But on the back end, we had a fiscal of $1 million for over the biennium. Well, I'm a fiscal conservative. If you're gonna, you find where, don't tell me you wanna do something out of kindness of your heart if you're not gonna pay for it. And we were gonna have to increase the budget, Medicaid budget, by $1 million for the biennium budget. So my amendment said, the governor already had a 2% increase in Medicaid, and which included the assisted living facilities, or any, there's also people who stay at home can get, if they, but anyway, they call that the cash fund, of 2%. And I said, well, wait a minute. I looked up inflationary rates, and it's expected to be 5.5% this next year. Gas price is going down.
Although there are different measures that might. Right.
And I think I looked up the medical one was supposed to be like 0.75%. That was all it was supposed to be expected.
That seems really hard to believe. 0.75% medical inflation?
Well, you got to remember who's president and who wants to make sure Obamacare looks good, but that it's controlling spending. But anyway, I found that off the, I can't remember, Department of Labor or wherever. So I'm sitting there going, wait a second, we can cut that to 1.75%, makes our increase revenue neutral, doesn't affect the budget. So I put that amendment in.
And then you withdrew it based on the argument that the time for that is later on, and you're going to be fighting the budget.
Oh yeah,
later
I just sent a shot across the bow. Some senators got excited and said it was not germane, but it was ruled germane because it was.
But aside from the procedural question and the timing, there was also the argument that, well, you're sticking it to the nursing homes. You're going to make them eat the cost because the people, the patients, are going to be able to keep more of their money that would otherwise have gone to the nursing homes, and therefore, if you don't have the Medicaid increase, those institutions are going to suffer.
It's the old. I can use the other side's rationale when they ask for a 5% increase, and they tell you when they settle for 3%, they say, "Well, we agreed to a 2% cut." You didn't agree to any cut. You still got a 3% increase. They were still going to get a 1.75% increase on Medicaid per diems. But the other side of that was that we hadn't changed that since 1999, where it was $50. And at that time, the minimum Social Security payment was $500. Since then, that hasn't sat still. It went to $733. So they had gotten a $233 increase from at the minimum, because that's the minimum people who were getting Social Security, while the individual was only getting $50. They didn't get their little increase all the time. So they had extra resources there too. But the reality is what came first, the egg or the chicken? Is part of the reason we have such huge medical inflation is because of government actions? Could it be that maybe because we...
Well, you referenced Obamacare and you said in medical inflation is 0.75%.
Well, he's...
Which
he's,
one is it? I mean, saying we have big medical
inflation?
We
had in the past.
Okay.
We all agree to that. But the projections is it's supposed to be 0.75%.
Now, you also made in the course of that discussion last week a point about protecting institutions versus protecting taxpayers. What would you go over that? Do you recall that?
Institutions and corporations and businesses and don't have a soul and they can't register to vote. I represent individuals. I represent the people who pay the taxes. I pay the people who get the benefit. I represent the people who get the benefits. I don't represent institutions. And one of the things that bothers me down here is I hear from occupations. I hear from businesses. I hear from banks. I hear from... But I very seldom hear from somebody who walks up to me and say, I'm a citizen, and this is what I'd like done. I hear that back home when I walk the streets, but I don't hear it in Lincoln, Nebraska.
You said in your most recent letter that you came down here and you thought you were going to be a $12,000 a year government employee, but you've since changed your mind.
Well, I'm trying to be humorous. I never make it as a stand-up comic, but...
Well, we're sitting, you know.
But anyway, Fred, people have always asked me, and the reporters and stuff, what is it like what you expected? And my first answer was, well, I thought I was a $12,000 a year government employee, and then after a while I figured out I was a very low-paid $12,000 a year bank loan officer, because everybody's... And I work for the biggest bank in Nebraska, because everybody walks in them doors looking for money and lobbyists, and they don't plan on paying it back. But recently what I've been doing on the floor of the legislature is more like maybe a deacon of a secular humanist church, because we're doing our good works with our neighbors' tax dollars, and we're trying to make people feel better about their sexual preferences and their addictions to recreational drugs. So I was being humorous, but it seems sometimes that's where we're at.
Well, and yet you said it's a secular humanist church, and yet you and I have talked before. You also think that some religious denominations kind of channel their charitable impulses through government?
Through government. It's a twisted, maybe Senator Chambers is right. Maybe some people follow the Bible instead of the Bible. But I can't find anywhere in the Bible. I don't want to get into religion, but... where it says I'm supposed to do my good works with my neighbor's tax dollars.
Okay. What do you think, if you carried your philosophy to the extreme, there might not be any government funding for common purposes. What do you think the proper sphere of
government is? Well, I believe government, when its actions benefit everybody. A road, a street, Capitol building, a courthouse, the law enforcement, public safety, the fire department, good roads. It's where it's for the common good. But you do always have that place where you need to make sure people have a roof over their head, have a full stomach, because that is the common good. You don't want folks in the streets. But we carry the pendulum swings too far sometimes, where we actually harm people. We take away their drive. We take away their self-worth. And I have, that's just my personal philosophy, where government sometimes should show a little bit more tough love.
So when it comes to the state budget and the, I gather you're going to be proposing some amendments to it.
I might do it again.
Are there big areas where you think money could be saved?
Education. I think it's time this. And I've been talking to other senators to tell the University of Nebraska it's time to use a little fiscal management. You're getting a little too big for your britches. You're coming for too much money. You're trying to act like an economic development company. And it's time to buck up. And because you've been swallowing an awful lot of the budget and increases. There's one. Education. I'd actually like to spend increase state aid to education so we can do property tax relief. Because that is, by our Constitution, a directive to provide a free education. And it's also in our Constitution that we don't have any rights since Tiemann, and we did, you know, in the 60s where we did income and sales tax, that the state does not have a right to issue a property tax for state purposes, but we do it through schools. They claim it's the local school district, but when you have a mandate, you have to have a certain mill levy before you get state aid. I would argue that. So I'm not... We need public schools, but we need to make them more efficient, and we also need to fund them. And then that's where I see property tax relief coming, instead of this bait and switch where we switch. People pay income and sales taxes, and then you turn around and give a rebate on your property taxes. Well,
that's the property tax credit.
Yeah, and I think we ought to just do what constitutionally we're supposed to do. I mean, it's like I told one senator, if I walk in at a Quick Stop and I fill up with gas and I pay too much for my gas and I go back in and buy a can of pop and a newspaper and I give them $5 and they give me $2 back, did I get a refund on my gas? No, I didn't. But that's kind of what they're playing with.
Okay. Well, we look forward to you making those arguments, and we'll see how far you get when the budget comes up, next month, right?
I'm showing up every day, and Senator Hadley at the speaker and pointing me in the right direction and what we're doing, and I'm learning. But I am passionate, and I have certain beliefs, and I believe you only go around once in life, and I live by a couple of tenets, and one of them is I when I get down, I read the obituaries, and I ask myself if that person could be here one more day, one more week. Would they worry about what their neighbor thought of them, or would they do the right thing? And those kind of beliefs I have, and that's why I guide myself.
Okay, and there are probably several people that are hoping they'll see your name in that obituary column.
I shouldn't say it. But I have a list that I have to make sure that I see the marker before I can go. So that motivates me to stay around longer.
All right. Well, we're
goes
glad,
both ways.
We're glad you're here. We're glad you came in today.
Thanks,
thank
Fred.
You very much.
Yep.
Stay put. Well, I just say this has been NET News Capital Conversations. You can catch us on the web at netnebraska.org/news. We'll have another discussion next week and hope to see you then.